Once on a hillside, people were gathered, hoping to see it as thousands were fed. He touched the blind eyes, healed broken spirits. He moved with compassion. He raised up the dead. Once on a watching as Jesus was crucified, no one showed mercy to the one who had healed them. Yet Jesus loved them as he suffered and died. Once on a hillside, people were gathered, for Jesus had risen and soon would ascend. Then as he blessed them, he rose to the heavens and he gave them his
Thank you, John. Wonderful song. Wonderful singing. All right, let's go back to John chapter 17. I told you we'd be here 2 or 3 weeks or so, maybe a little longer. I don't know. We'll see. And I kind of did a little overview, a little bit of the high priestly prayer, John chapter 17. And of course, this is a prayer of the Lord Jesus. And you know, Jesus, of course, he was a man, but at the same time, he was God. He was 100, he wasn't 50-50. He was 100% man and 100% God. And if he, as a man, if he needs to pray, why did he pray? And it was to keep close communion with the Father. And if he needs to pray, how much more do you and I need to pray? If he was perfect in every way, how much more do we need to pray? And so as we're looking at this, of course, this is the intercessory prayer. And I got to thinking about that a little bit. You know, in Isaiah 53, it says that he made intercession for the transgressors. And so when did he do that? He did it all of his life. All of his life, that's what he's done. As a matter of fact, 1 Timothy chapter 2, it says this. It says that there is one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. One mediator, or the go-between, the intercessor. That's what that means. As a matter of fact, when he was dying on the cross, he was interceding for people. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He was interceding there. And now, the Bible tells us he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he ever liveth to make intercession for us. That's what he's doing at this very moment. And so, and we go again from his words and his praying here to his work. His work is Calvary. That's what he came to do, to seek and to save that which was lost. But then he's praying here in chapter 17, and immediately after this, he's going to be going to Calvary. He goes to the Garden of Gethsemane, and then he'll be arrested, and he'll give himself into the hands of sinners to be crucified. And by the way, let me just say, how do we have our prayers answered? You know, this prayer does not end with "in Jesus' name." Have you ever noticed that? It does not end that way. How do our prayers end? Most every prayer that you hear, tacked on the end of it, what does somebody say? Because here's the thing, the only way that we get to the Father is through Jesus Christ. One mediator, remember? The man Christ Jesus. One, not a few or a couple, there's one, and his name is Jesus. And so when we say our prayer, or when we're praying, we say in Jesus' name, because here's the thing, we can't go to God on our own merit or our own behalf. We go on the behalf and on the merit of Jesus Christ. That's how we approach him. That's how we approach God. And so that's how our prayers end. How does his prayer begin? What is it prayer? In verse 17, chapter 17, verse number 1. Father. It sounds real familiar to the model prayer. Remember that? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Sounds real familiar, doesn't it? It's heavenward. It's Godward. That's where he's praying. And the only way that we can approach God, the only way that we'll ever, the way that the veil has been removed and we can enter into the throne of grace to find mercy is through Jesus Christ and his intercessory work. But I'm going to read through this passage one more time. We read it last week. We're going to read it one more time. But I want you to pay attention to something. I want you to notice a word as we're going through there. I want you to notice the word glory. All right? I want you to notice that as we're reading down through here. It's mentioned eight times. Eight times in this one chapter is mentioned glory. And so, and let me just say that real prayer, true prayer, if we are to pray a prayer that is to be heard of God, there has to be an underlying purpose. And that underlying purpose, that one purpose, is God's glory. And God's glory is the hinge on which every true prayer will swing. You want to get your prayers heard? Did Jesus get his prayers heard? You want to get your prayers heard? It's going to involve getting glory to God. So let's read it. Chapter 17, verse number 1. And just kind of pick out the times that uses the word glory. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also glorify thee. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. All of mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I am come to thee. Holy Father, keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And now come I to thee, and these things speak I in the world, that they might have the joy in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which believe on me through their word. Remember, he's praying for you in this passage, if you're a believer. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee. That they also may be one in us, and the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. There it is again. The glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. That they may be as one, even as we are one. I and them, and thou and me, that thou may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved me as thou hast loved me. Love them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee, and these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and I will declare it, that the love wherein thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them. Now, that's a prayer. That's a prayer that the Lord Jesus was giving. Now, I just want to point out, look in verse number 1. Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Now, look in verse number 4. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Verse number 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had before the world was. Verse number 10. And all mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. Verse number 22. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Verse number 24. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. This passage is completely full of that. Did you notice that before? It's completely full of the word glory. There's another word we'll look at. The word give, or givest, is another word that is mentioned throughout there. It's mentioned more times than actually glory. But as we look at this, our prayer ought to be, most of our prayers are selfish. Lord, give me this. Help me here. Do this. But a real prayer, real true prayer that God is going to hear is one that glorifies Him. One that glorifies Him. And is God glorified in your prayers? You know, when Moses, when he was on Mount Sinai, you remember the story? He went to go get the Ten Commandments. He saw God. And he asked this. He said, show me thy glory. He said, show me thy glory. But he had a purpose behind it, and he said, that I may know thee. Why is God going to show you his glory? So that he can reveal himself. That's the only reason. Not because you're so good and you deserve it. Not because, or any other reason, but because He is worthy to be glorified. And so I want to go through, I think I've actually have, how many did I put down there? Five things. All right, we got to fly through this, all right? We got to fly through this. All right, so the first thing here, the glory that Jesus had before. Look in verse number 5. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. This is, you may think, oh, before Bethlehem, you're going to glorify him before Bethlehem. No. This goes way before that. It says, before the world was. As a matter of fact, before Genesis 1, when it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And I've given you this before, but in the beginning is time. God created the heavens, that's the space, and the earth, that's matter. Before there was time, space, and matter, Jesus was there. Before the world was. Jesus Christ is co-equal, co-existent, eternally existent with God the Father. He is God. He is the Creator. That's who Jesus is. As a matter of fact, Matthew, it tells us that He is Emmanuel, God with us. But the glory that He had before the world was. He's not praying for Himself. He says, it almost seems like, glorify thy Son, that thy Son may glorify thee. Now, I'm going to elaborate how He does this in our own lives. But when God is being glorified through your life, and you're praying, God, would you glorify me as I glorify you, and God's going to get glory through you. This is what He's praying here. He's not praying to the Lord to just exalt me. He's saying, Lord, exalt me as I exalt you. Glorify me as I glorify you. And so in essence, what He's doing, He's not really praying to glorify Himself. He's praying to glorify the Father. That's what He's praying here. By the way, all glory is connected with God. All glory is. Because, again, Jesus, he existed before the world ever was. He didn't have a beginning. As a matter of fact, there's a place in the Bible where it says He's from everlasting to everlasting. He had no beginning, had no end. As a matter of fact, it calls Him the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. But there is no beginning with Him, and there is no ending with Him. He always is. He's the ever-present God. He's the ever-present I Am. That's who the Lord is. And so this is the glory that He had before the world was. Now let's look at a second one. The glory that Jesus gave through His earthly life. Look in verse number 1 again. These words spake Jesus and lifted up His eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. The hour is come. How many times as you're reading the Bible, you will see in our D group, we've pretty much gone through the Gospels now. And how many times that pops up, the hour has not come. Mine hour is not yet come. Mine hour is not yet come. But here we are, we're at His hour. And isn't it funny? It's interesting. What is an hour? What is an hour? In this particular case, it's not a 60-minute period of time. It is a season, all right? The hour. We're at Sunday morning hour. Now, if the preacher preaches an hour, that's a long time. But you know, it's an hour. It's a season of time or a period of time. But what he's saying here, there's a period where it begins and there's a period where it ends. Does that make sense? The hour is come. Now, what is he talking about? He's talking about the hour he was about to be crucified. He was about to accomplish the purpose for which he came, and that is to pay the sin debt of all men, to offer salvation to all who would believe. And so that's what he came to do, to seek and to save that which was lost. And so he says, the hour is come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. And so that hour. Now, how many times throughout his life did you hear things like this? You saw it at the Mount of Transfiguration. You saw it at his baptism. You saw it like that, and it says, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Remember that? When did he glorify God? Do you think Jesus had bad days just like you and I have bad days? I don't I mean circumstantial. I don't mean my attitude. I'm talking about things that happen to you that you can't control and you just don't like. Do you think Jesus had days like that? He absolutely did. But you know, there was never a day where he sinned in his sadness or his circumstances or anything like that. He never had the wrong attitude, never. Now you and I, we can't say that. But Jesus never did. So he glorified Jesus throughout his eternal life. He was sinless in every way. Let me say it this way. He succeeded in every way that you and I fail. Let that sink in. He succeeded in every way that you and I fail. He never fails. He will never let you down. How many of you have had somebody, a friend, a family, a spouse that have let you down before? All of us could raise our hand. All of us. But Jesus will never let you down. Through his eternal life, through his life, his earthly life, through his eternal life, he is one that will never fail, never let us down. He gives glory to God the entire time. As a matter of fact, Philippians, let's talk about his ministry here. Philippians chapter 2. Verse number 5, just listen. It says, "Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." He was obedient all the way to death. He lived his entire life for what purpose? To the glory of who? Of God the Father. That's the way it was. So we have the glory that he had before, the glory that he had during his ministry or his earthly life. And then the next one is the glory that Jesus gave at the end of his earthly ministry. Look in verse number 1 and 2 again. "These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him." Now, let's talk about the end of his earthly ministry. Look at it says, "Thou hast given him power over all flesh." Now, this reminds me of a verse. Do you remember the verse that before, just as he was ascending into heaven and his disciples were standing around and he was going back to heaven, and what did he say? He says, "All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Go and make disciples of all nations." You remember those verses, but there's a word there, "All power is given unto me." And it says here that thou hast given him power over all flesh. Again, that hour is a set period of time. That hour is a set period of time. And aren't you glad that an hour is a set period of time? Look, Jesus was about to go to his hour of sadness, his hour of suffering, his hour of suffering on the cross. He was about to do that. But what makes it better? Because Jesus was looking at the other side. You understand? At the other side. He was entering into the cross. He was entering into that time of suffering. He was about to be beaten and whipped and all that for us in our stead. But the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 2, that it says, "And for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross." So for you and I as believers, if Jesus is looking at his suffering and looking at his trials, and he can look beyond that suffering and look beyond that trial, look beyond that hour, knowing that the joy that was coming, knowing that the display of power in his resurrection was going to be had, and he could look at that with joy, and he was looking on the other side of that, how much more should you and I? Look, are we going to go through trials? Are we going to go through troubles? Are we going to go through disappointments? Absolutely. But I want you to know that it is only for a period of time. It is not going to last forever. So he was looking at his time of temptation, his time at the cross, and he was looking at the resurrection. He was looking at the empty tomb. He was looking at the ascension. He was looking at all of that. He was given power over all flesh. He was looking at not what he had to go through, but he was looking at God, what God was going to do on the other side of all of that. You know what he was doing on the other side of all of that? He was giving you and I salvation. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. As a matter of fact, what about was God exalted? Was God glorified through Jesus Christ because of all of that? Well, let me read a verse to you. It's in Psalm 24. Now look, we saw it at his baptism. We saw it at the ascension. We saw it at the transfiguration, and then his ascension there, and then he was exalted even after that. What do you think that it looked like when Jesus walked into heaven after the ascension? What do you think that looked like? Can you imagine that? I mean, after the cross, after the resurrection, what do you think that looked like? Well, look, I'm going to give you just a little synopsis here. This is Psalms 24. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. That's what it looked like. So the first thing, Jesus had glory before. He had glory through his life. He had glory at the end of his earthly ministry and even now. But then there's a glory that Jesus gives us. Look in verse number 22. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them. We share in this. Now, there's a glory that he does not share. You understand, God does not share his glory, meaning credit or being worthy. The only thing that we have is to glorify him. But he has done something for us. And I want to read something. 17 times in this passage, it uses the word give. And he's mentioned here about giving us glory. Not because we get credit, but what has God given you, spiritually speaking or eternally speaking? What has God given you? I want to read a verse about that, and it's in 2 Peter, chapter number 1, verse number 3. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we may be partakers by the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. What does he give us? Look, even down here in the last verses there, verse 26 of chapter 17 of John, it says, "And I declare unto them thy name, and I will declare it, and the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, I in them." What is something that Jesus has given you? And I'm going to tell you, when you have experienced his love, that's some of his glory that he's given to you. When you have read a promise in the Bible and you can claim that promise and you see that promise come to fruition in your life and you know it was the hand of God, that's his glory that you're experiencing and then you're getting a taste of and you're getting to see. And he says, "My people, I've given him my glory. I've given it to him." Have you experienced his glory like that before? What about salvation? He's given to you eternal life. He's placed himself inside of you. He's placed his spirit. He loves you, cares for you. Never leave you, never forsake you. Given you life eternal. And we've been partakers of that. So we can look at it this way. We give him our house now. He lives in us, and later on, we're going to live in his house later on. That's the way it looks. But he gives us glory. He gives us glory. But then also the last one, the glory that Jesus gets from us. Look in verse number 9 and 10 again. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine, and mine are thine, and thine are mine. And what does it say? And I am glorified in them. There's a glory that God gets from you. How does God get glory from you? As a matter of fact, he's talking about the world. It's kind of, the Bible tells us, for God so loved the world. But then he says, I'm not praying for the world, I'm praying for them. That kind of sounds a little bit like he don't love the world, does it? But that's not what he's saying here. What he's saying here is, I have some men, and he's talking to his disciples right here. I have some people that I have given glory, I have given my word, I have given my love, I have given them all of that. I have given them all the spiritual blessings that I can possibly give them. I've given them all the promises. I've given them this. And it is through them I'm going to touch the world. And it is through them I'm going to make myself known to this world. As a matter of fact, look down. Let me see here. Verse 21, that all may be one as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. What does he want from his disciples? That the world may believe that thou hast sent me. He's trying to reveal Jesus. He's trying to reveal himself. Now, as he reveals himself to us, his glory has been revealed to us. Then in turn, we reveal his glory to this world so that the world might know who he really is. That's what this is about. And this is the prayer that he's praying about glory. Now look, and as we experience God's glory through his promises and through his love and through all of that, you know what? That has a ripple effect. You know, I have thought many times, we have drug problems in our county, there's no doubt about it. We have other issues in our county. How in the world do we address that? Let me tell you how we address that. The only way that it can ever be addressed, now look, we can arrest them, we can throw them in jail, we can come down hard on them, man, we can, but I'm going to tell you what, that's not going to fix it. It will not fix it. The only thing that will fix it is divine intervention. The God of heaven stepping in. And you know how the God of heaven is going to step in? It's not going to be because we're sitting here and we're pointing our fingers out there. It's because we've experienced God's glory. And now, in turn, we're trying to make the world see God's glory also, and trying to make him known. That's the way it's going to be fixed. If we would first experience God's glory for ourselves, you know what would happen? It would have a ripple effect. It would have a ripple effect all around our country, all around our community, all around our county if we would do that. How is God glorified through our life? As we believe him, as we trust him, as we obey him, as we give truth, as we receive truth and we give truth, and as we make his glory known. That's how God is glorified through your life and through my life. Let me ask you something, and I've given you information this morning. It hadn't been real pointed, but I do want to point something out here. How much glory is God getting from your life? What are you living for? I mean, if all we're living for is to pay our mortgage, to get a new car, is that what we're living for? For me to live is my job. For me to live is my family. Is that what Paul said? What did he say? For me to live is Christ. And I'm going to tell you, the only way that we'll make Christ known to this world is as we experience his glory internally. As he's real to us and he reveals himself to us, then and only then can we reveal him to other people. The Bible says that it's passed from faith to faith. How did you get saved? How did you come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ? It's because somebody that knew Christ showed you the way to Christ by using God's word, by using truth. Knowing that you're a sinner, knowing that Jesus paid your sin debt, and by believing what Jesus has done, and then and only then can you be saved. It's not because of doing good things, or because I go to church, or anything like that. But it's passed from faith to faith. You know that God's glory is passed that way as well. You know, what God wants to do with you is to reveal himself to others through you. He wants to reveal himself to you, but he also wants to reveal himself through you to the rest of the world. This is his prayer. And I say to you that he wants to do so much more of that. And I want to ask you a question. How much glory are you revealing to this world around you? Look, we just went through a week that is hectic and tired. I'm still tired. We can neglect all sorts of spiritual disciplines. We can neglect our time with the Lord. We can do all that. But I'm going to tell you, the Lord wants to reveal himself. He reveals himself through his word, through prayer. He reveals himself that way. And you cannot make him known to the world if he hasn't made himself known to you. I want to ask you a question. Do you know Christ as your Savior? Has there ever been a time in your life where you repented of your sin and you placed your faith wholeheartedly in Jesus, him and him alone, nothing else, not the church, not baptism, not anything else, but you said, I believe Christ and what he did for me, and I believe him for my soul's salvation? If there's never been a time like that in your life, I want to tell you, you're lost and undone on your way to hell. That's clear teaching of the Bible. But then at the same time, some of us as Christians, we can get cold and complacent in our Christianity. And the love of Christ can wax cold in our heart because we've allowed it. And he wants it to be hot. He wants it to be red hot. He wants it to be white hot. So the glory, his glory. Let me tell you something. Moses, when he came off that mountain, Mount Sinai, his face was shining and glowing because he had been in the presence of God. He'd seen God's glory. Not for himself, but so that he could share with other people. He could make God known and that he could be known. He could show me thy glory that I may know you. That's what he says. The disciples, they saw God's glory at the transfiguration. They said, man, it's good to be here. Let's build 3 tabernacles and let's just stay here a while. I'm going to tell you, I have a feeling because I need this. The promises that God gives, his love that he shares, the truth that he gives, I need that. I need his glory so that I can be the person God wants me to be and I can glorify him through my life. How much glory is God getting from your life? This is Jesus' prayer that he's praying for you and I. Those 5 glories that I gave you, that he had before the world was, while his life was going on, he was giving God glory at the end of his life. And now he's giving it to us, and now he wants to get glory from us, through us. How much glory is your life given to God? How much glory is he getting from you? Only you can answer that. Perhaps you don't know Christ. We can take God's word and let you know what God says, not my opinion. We can let you know what God says about going to heaven, about what salvation is all about if you need that. Maybe you have some other burden on your heart, on your life. Maybe there's somebody you want to come pray for. I don't know. I just know that God wants to hear from us. God wants to commune with us. God wants to get glory from us. And our prayers all ought to be about his glory, glorifying him in every way that we possibly can, even in our prayers, even when we need something, to glorify him through that need. Let's stand together. We're singing a hymn of invitation.